All right, sound like we're a little bit of an older church from back in the day. Just singing with nobody else singing in our hymn books right there. It's good. It's good. Good words. All right, so today we're in Luke chapter 2. I'm going to pull it up right here. You know, I got the privilege yesterday to talk to some Jehovah Witnesses that came to my door. You know, we're sitting there on a Saturday morning, and as we're sitting there on a Saturday morning, I see a car in the drive. Everybody's kind of waking up. I've already been up for a while. I wake up early doing service on Saturdays and other things. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I got to get my clothes on. I'm so excited. They've come. And I got my stuff ready, and I went to the door, and it was something because we have a ring system for cameras, so I got the whole thing on video. My boy sat there and watched it all, and listen, he's going to make a video of this thing. And I could see, it was kind of nice, because I could see things I did do a lot better the last times I talked to him. And then I could also see, like, I cut him off sometimes. I shouldn't have cut somebody off when I'm listening to him, things like that to hear him out. But I tell you, one thing they tried to tell me about the coming kingdom, and we just finished up Revelation, and they told me that, you know, we're going to live on paradise on earth forever. That's what they believe. They're going to die, you're going to rot in the ground, and one day the Lord's going to raise you up, and you're just going to be able to live like we live right now, except without the trouble right here on earth, and like a picture of the Garden of Eden. And I said, oh, let me tell you, the Bible says it's so much better than that. If you read Revelation chapter 22, we're going to be living in a kingdom where there's no more curse. There's no more sin. There's no more serpent that's in that garden. It's going to be so much more grand than the Garden of Eden. And that's what God has in store for us. And then I tried to tell them some other things too. But I don't want to send the whole sermon here to that. But let me tell you, they left talking to me. I didn't kick them out. But I hope they come back. And I'll be more prepared if they do. But I tell you, it's tough because when you face somebody with a false religion that's a cult like that, it's tough because it makes my heart beat because I have to calm myself down as I rush to the door with my jacket on and my sleep pants on because I don't want to get angry. I don't want to like just let that just rip out on them and then what good is that going to be? I got to think these are two living souls that have come to my door who honestly believe the lies that they're talking about. And I want to try to help them and bring them to hear what the real gospel is all about Jesus. So I kept focusing back on Christ and who Christ is and how if they miss Christ as being God, they miss it all. And I've got to keep doing better and better at that. But I did appreciate them coming. And I did compliment them on the way they know their doctrine so well. I said, us Christians should know our doctrine so well as they do. They know what they believe. They know why they believe it. He has Bible flipping up back and forth all over the place. And I'm like, I very much appreciate that. And that's the same way we should be as well. But I don't think that you're missing it. And you're missing it. The main point is Jesus. And it was a good conversation. But it was something. But who knows, they may be coming to your door next, okay? And I got a wonderful thing. If you think they're coming and you want to know a little more about them, I recommended these guys, but I doubt they're going to do it. But I'm going to print one out for next time they come. And there's a book called The Kingdom of the Cults, written by Walter Martin, okay? And Walter Martin wrote 91 pages about the Jehovah's Witnesses in there. From their history, their doctrines, what the Bible says, it's incredible. And it's scholarly. It's not some guy's biased emotional views. It's something that's real, literal research right there on them. And if you want that, need to email it to you or something, or heck, I'll even print it out if you're really serious for yourself for it, let me know. So that way you might be able to engage them as well, too. So.
I noticed one thing about those kingdom halls, they never have any windows.
Yeah, there's no windows. I don't know what the purpose in that is, that there's no windows. It's something strange, but there's not one window in the kingdom hall. If they had windows, they brick them all up. So it's really strange. Anytime you drive, there's one right over here on Sleepy Hollow. You can drive by that, see it's like that. There's one over here on 82 in Columbia Station. None of them have any windows. So it's a strange thing. So I don't know. But let me get started with this. This is a picture of possibly an angel. And you look at this, you're like, that looks like it's out of some scary child book or something, right? Fairy tale book. But really, when we think about angels, our society has painted all these pretty little girls with wings on their cells, or little babies with wings. There's nowhere in the Bible that pictures an angel like that whatsoever, okay? This has come along through man's time and man's ideas. This is more what the Bible pictures an angel. I couldn't find a picture that I did justice. I think this picture was pretty close. It has like six wings. His Revelation says they have six wings. Or Ezekiel says four wings. It says they have eyes all over the place. You see those dark spots? Those are eyeballs all over. In Ezekiel, it said there was a wheel inside of a wheel turning with eyeballs all over it. You know, maybe that's another type of an angel or something. Maybe that's part of the angel. I don't know. But there was also heads, and the heads have two to four faces, depending on where you read in the Bible, describing what the angel looks like, and they're from like an ox head, a lion head, a human head, all on the same head with different sides of the head with different faces. And as I read that scripture passage to you, it said they were terrified, the shepherds were, when this angel showed up right there. And I have a feeling if a real angel showed himself to us, we'd be terrified too. And as I tried to look for pictures, there's like little videos made if you look at what do angels really look like. And the ones I found were all written by people who don't believe in God, that's for sure. And one of them tried to cite, well, these people who are believers or Christians, imagine they really believe they're going to live in all of eternity with these weird-looking creatures. As if this is something like you'll choose, that's not where I want to live. Oh my, this is terrible. But I did try to appreciate some of the research or something, but the best is what the Bible says. But this is what I did. I grabbed a picture of an angel, possibly a picture of an angel, that somebody's imagination went from what the Bible describes it as, not as what our culture describes it as. And the angels do sometimes take the form of humans too. We see that through the Bible too. They show up and you don't know you're talking to an angel. But other times they're in these kind of forms that are tremendous, all right? And I wrote on here, Mary had the best baby announcement of all. You know how ladies, they're going to have a baby and they decide to announce to everybody they had a baby. And these days they post pictures on Facebook or whatever they do. But think about the angels brought the announcement of the baby. You can't get a better announcement than that. That the angels of God Almighty are announcing the birth of your child to these other people. Imagine that announcement. I mean, outdoes every single announcement we could think of as a human being, an announcement of a baby. And it's a beautiful thing right here. And the theme of this angel song is, how did God come? How did he come to the earth? And that's what we're going to see throughout this, all right? I'll get started. I hope I have enough material that I don't shortchange you guys today on the sermon, all right? I usually always do, but I don't know. All right, we'll see. All right, in the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. All right, these are the shepherds, and they're out there in the field at nighttime. And look at what the focus is. The focus wasn't on those who have status. If you think about, like, King Charles, right? His name, King Charles, that just took over from Elizabeth when she died. And if we looked at the news and stuff, we saw these giant churches with all kinds of incredible looks inside. And we saw tons of people all dressed all nice and fancy. And all this pomp and tradition and things that make our mind think, I wonder what that means and what does this mean? And it was so much beauty. When Jesus, who's the King of Kings and the most center of all things, the most important of everybody, was born, he came to some shepherds out there in a field, okay? That's where Jesus' big announcement was made. And it wasn't in some grandeur type of place, all right? And this isn't the type of God somebody would make up. If you were to make up a God, if you were to make up some fantasy religion and try to pretend believe it or convince others to believe it, you wouldn't have him being born in a manger where animals are, and you wouldn't have him coming to the first people the angels get excited and talk about is to a bunch of shepherds. You know, shepherds, we used to have a guy named Joe. Joe Gordon used to come to this church. He might be watching. Who knows? Good guy. Come back, Joe, if you're watching. But Joe Joe, I used to say, I preached this before, Joe was here once, not the exact, I never do the same sermon, but I preached this passage area. And I said, these guys were just a bunch of regular Joes. That's who the shepherds were. They were your regular Joes just hanging out. You know, it would be like you and I or something. I think of myself as a regular Joe, actually. Just walking down the street or something, and boom, a giant heavenly host of angels shows up and starts to tell you the good news. And this is what went down. And they point out, this points out for sure, we know God is real just from situations like this. And the shepherds were known to be unsavory characters who were not even allowed to testify in court. So say if there was a murder or something crazy went on and the shepherds were a witness, they wouldn't even let them say something in court. That's how lowly society thought about these shepherds, all right? They didn't think of them as highly in any kind of sense. They were ceremonially unclean because they had to work every Sabbath. The Sabbath was a big deal. You know, the fourth commandment was, thou shalt not work on the Sabbath. And when you look in the Bible, God once had Moses kill a man who was picking up sticks on the Sabbath. And it was God's voice that told Moses, kill this man. You know, he's to die for the sin of picking up sticks on the Sabbath. And these shepherds, what were they supposed to do? They had to take care of their animals. They, you know, a sheep doesn't know to say, hey, stay put while I go and worship the Lord and spend time with my family and just spend this in the time of the Sabbath and I don't do any work. You know, the sheep have to have a shepherd. But yet at the same time, as we look through the Bible, shepherds have an honorable place because Moses spent some time being a shepherd. King David was a shepherd boy, and Jesus is called the great shepherd, the shepherd of us. So we don't see shepherds as something that all of us should look down upon or something, but we see it as something also that God uses. And I'll tell you something we'll see throughout this sermon, throughout this passage, is humbleness, okay? God came to us in a humble manner, and he leads the way, and truly a good leader leads the way in the way that the people ought to go. And Christ led in humility and humbleness when he came to this earth. He was truly the suffering servant when he came. And we can see how he came showing these shepherds, how he came born in a manger. And none of this was accidental. All this was pre-planned, predestined from before all time. And the people back then knew it. You know, there's a prophecy in Micah 5:2 that said he'd be born in Bethlehem. And think about Bethlehem was a long ways off from where Galilee was, but all of a sudden, all these events God orchestrated with God's hands to make it so that they would have to travel a long ways while she's pregnant, that she would end up having a baby in a manger, okay? All of this was God's plan, God's working out, and it's just amazing to see God in the details. When I see God in the details like that in the Bible, it makes me think God's in the details like that in my life, and he's in the details like that in your life as well, too. And all these things that we think are so terrible or so woeful, we can have a better perspective if we know this is all part of the plan details from God. Of everything that's going on, God has got this. So we see, and an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. And just imagine that, you know. So I wrote, angels are scary looking. A lot of places in the Bible, they fall down in great fear. This isn't the only place. Imagine seeing these creatures, like maybe the one I showed you before, where some pop up. Oh, my. Some people might just have heart attacks right there, you know. Don't you hear about some people sometimes, they did all this stuff, and all of a sudden they had a heart attack. You know, somebody told me just yesterday or today about somebody that turned 100 years old. They had their 100th birthday. And on their 100th birthday, after they looked at a picture of their, it was a lady, looked at the picture of her husband from years ago and had her birthday cake and stuff. And she'd always said, I'm going to die on my 100th birthday. They stepped out of the room and they were going to, it was a nurse that told me this. She stepped out of the room to get the pills for the patient. She came back and the patient was dead. It was like just that fast. So think about this. If sometimes folks can get older and just die from that, imagine what happened if an angel showed up. Some of us might go to be with the Lord right there and then. That's not a bad thing, though, to be with the Lord, okay? But they're terribly frightened. And think about the glory of God and what it looks like. Think about how the shining glory of God. We did Revelation. It says there's no more night, there's no more sun, that the light all comes from Christ. Can you imagine a place that's so well lit? My imagination for my perception leads me to 5,000 watt LEDs, you know, cool, what do they call it, cool daytime or cool something, day cool, like when you go to buy your lights and they have this intensely bright light color. You can see it at night. If you look at someone's house that's maybe older, that's never replaced their old light bulbs, like the regular old style ones, they look kind of yellow. And if you look at someone's house who has all the LEDs, it's like this bright white is going on. I could just imagine that times a million times is what that must have looked like when the angels came and the glory of the Lord shone on them. You know, think about transfiguration. When that transfiguration happened, it said they saw Jesus in his glory. Imagine what that would have looked like. I told that to those JWs that came to my house. We talked about life after death, and I said, you guys don't even believe when you die, you go anywhere. You believe you just rot in the ground. I said, what about the transfiguration? What about Jesus showing up with Moses and Elijah? And they said, oh, that's just a vision. Visions aren't always real. And I said, oh, this is really playing with some words and stuff and trying to make your stuff fit. This is kind of sad that you hold to that. But when they saw that, they saw them in this glory. And they saw Jesus in his glory and in this terrible, incredible white light. He says, but the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. So the angels didn't bring judgment, okay? A lot of times in the Bible, angels do bring judgment, okay? You know, you got one angel in the time of King Sennacherib when he was coming against Hezekiah, and I think the number's 185,000 men he killed in one night all by himself. One angel, one night, wiped out 180 men. I can't even imagine 185,000. That's got to be like, we go sometimes to the Cavs or to the Indians or something. That's like under 100,000 in there. Imagine like triple that amount of people and one angel just wipes every single one of them out in one night. So you do a lot of judgment with the angels, but these angels weren't coming for judgment. They were coming bearing good news, and they were bearing the gospel. And I wrote 1 Peter 1:8, and then I thought, you know what? What if I forget what 1 Peter 1:8 says? So look at this. Boom. There it is right here, all right? I don't want to mislead you. 1 Peter 1:8 says, and though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. Isn't that beautiful? That's the gospel right there. And how does this tie into this, you may ask? It says, news of great joy. And look at this. Inexpressible joy. Joy inexpressible. This is what happens when you're a believer and you believe in Jesus and you hold to him and you really realize what the gospel means, and it gives you joy inexpressible. You know, you could be somebody in the worst of troubles right now, in the worst of situations with seemingly no hope to the rest of this world, and yet have joy inexpressible in your heart. Because you know the gospel, you know Jesus loves you, you know that he came for you, you know that he exists, you know that he's real. It's so beautiful. Like what Peter said, even though you don't see him, you love him. And even though you don't see him now, you believe in him, okay? And what you do, you rejoice with joy inexpressible, and you're full of his glory, receiving as the outcome of your faith, what do you receive? The salvation of your souls. You know, salvation is wholeness, goodness. It's living with the Lord forever right there. It's beautiful. And I wrote on here, this is what life is all about. This is truly what life's all about. I got opportunity last night and this morning, okay? I got an opportunity. We had a Special Forces Association Christmas dinner. We do it every year. There's guys that live around here within, some of them live all the way down like in Mansfield or farther away than that. They all come here together because they were all Green Berets at one time. Most of these guys are Vietnam vets. I'm pretty much the baby in the group, which makes me feel good, the baby in the group. But some of them are still serving today. Some of them are just a few years old. One guy's a few years younger than me. He's still a major in the Army today. But it was so good to get to see him. And you know, one guy told me today is they were going to plan a National Guard Special Forces training event up here, where they utilize the local people in the training event like it used to be back in the day with Special Forces is about. And I said, sign me up. I said, they could use our church right here. We'll use it as a little G base or an operations center. I said, different things. And then they said they thought about it because some of these old guys were already talking to them. And they would like me because they said, because I'm so good at the PSYOP portion. And I said, what do you mean by PSYOPs? And they said, helping people see something different than what they see. Because I guess some of them watch me online, made me feel pretty good. Maybe they watched me right now, I don't know. But here's the thing is, I said, oh man, it got me fired up, you know? And I said how I keep saying this CNN worldview. And I said, I keep telling people, don't believe it. Don't buy into it. Don't go into the way that all the news is saying and all the media is saying and how everybody's trying to get you. I said, we've got to have a biblical world view. And he said, you know, for looking at the big military things in the world, we've got to try to help other countries and other places with all kinds of evil and trouble to not see it from the perspective they're seeing it from, so that they'll stand up against that and go in the right direction. And that's how he tied me into it. But it made me feel so good that some fellow recognized that I'm trying to help people all the time to see something from a different perspective. And truly, I hope and pray that every time I preach to you, I teach, I come across you, I'm bringing it from a true biblical perspective. Not my perspective, not my emotions, not my will, not my ideas, but what from the Bible says and how we should view it. And really, what is life all about from that perspective? It's all about Jesus Christ. It's all about Him. Everything is about Jesus right there. It should be our main focus, the center of our lives for everything we are. And with this, it says, for today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Man, I couldn't write enough up here, but I didn't want to make it too small, okay? But Lord is the same name of the Greek-speaking Jews that translated as the name of God, Yahweh, okay? The word Kyrios, okay, is the Greek word, and when they were going speaking Greek, the Greek-speaking Jews, when they would refer to Yahweh, Yahweh is from Exodus 3:14, when Moses says, what is your name? And he says, I am that I am. That's the word Yahweh right there, that self-existent one. He says that here they're saying, who is Christ the Lord, who's God Almighty, who's the self-existent one, is coming to you today. And this was huge. This was so big. And the angels were telling them that the Creator who made them and sustains them has stepped down into time and into the flesh. That's what he's letting them know, these shepherds. They were Jews, I'm sure. I'm sure they knew what the Scripture said. They'd been taught and they'd been raised in this way. And here they're telling them that the I Am, the one in the burning bush, God Almighty, the Creator of all things, has now been born as a baby today, has stepped down into the flesh to be with you. And it's truly the heart of the gospel message, that Christ became flesh. It's the heart of the message right here. And to call someone Lord is to also to acknowledge your submission, okay? We can't be Christians who think that we get to call all the shots and that we pick and choose. Like I said before, the best way that I understand this, when I was a kid, I liked some of these books that were choose your own adventure. You know, I would read the book and I would get to a page and some scary situations going on, and it gave me three choices. You know, I could fight the bad guys, I could run away from the bad guys, or I could do something else. And it would say, go to this page if you choose this choice or that choice. All right? That's a nice thing for a kid and in a fantasy world, but in real life, it's not like that. And it surely shouldn't be like that with our religion and how we see our faith. Truly, we should be in submission to God, and whatever God has said, that's what we follow, that's what we believe. And truly, our sinful human nature hates submission. Every one of us, if we really talk truly about how we feel inside, we don't want to submit to anybody. We want to glorify ourselves. We want to do it our way. We don't want to do it someone else's way. And this is like the sinful nature that separates us from God and that causes so much trouble and struggle within us right here. But we've got to submit. And when you say the word Lord, you are acknowledging your submission to whoever you call Lord. Okay? And here in this context, it means God. And I wrote Yahweh, John 8:24. And now you may say, what's John 8:24 say? Well, we got it right here. I went a little crazy today. My wife would get mad at me, I think. Therefore, I said to you that you will die in your sins. This is Jesus talking. For unless you believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. This is what Jesus said. And once again, this I am he, that's the same as the I am from Exodus 3:14. Unless you believe that Jesus is God Almighty, the great I am, then you're not going to have any hope. That's what Jesus said. He didn't do it like the culture today. I hear people all the time mistranslate what Jesus said, mistranslate what the Bible says. When you listen to the CNN worldview, they try to say we have lots of churches that also support our view. And they'll get somebody on there talking, and I'm like, oh my, this is terrible, okay? I loved it when, I think, Larry King, I think he's dead now, right? But I loved it when Larry King would have John MacArthur on there. And John MacArthur would get on there, and he would ask all these, he'd have a whole bunch of pastors and people, and Larry King would ask questions, and John MacArthur would say, no, you're going to die and go to hell. That's what's going to happen to you if you don't believe in Jesus. Like, he went that direct and that forceful, and everybody else was like, you got to believe whatever you believe, and just follow your heart. And John MacArthur was like, no, this is what the Bible says. And he wasn't afraid to say it, and I think that was on CNN too, right, Larry King? So there were some lights, some little bits of light that we shot through time. But I don't know if we got that stuff still going on with Larry King gone and such now. But this is what Jesus said. And truly, what does Yahweh mean? There's a whole lot if you look at it. But I think the best way to summarize it, it means he's self-existent. It means he's always existed. He doesn't need anyone. He doesn't need anyone else to sustain him. He doesn't need us to keep him alive or to give him glory or anything. He is God. For us, we're depending on the air, we're depending on our bodies, we're dependent on the food we eat, the water we drink. We depend on everything every day. We depend that the heater's working today, okay? I look at around the world what happened in crazy North Carolina and Moore County, how some crazies shot with bullets, shot up some electrical substation, and that 45,000 people went without heat, okay? I lived in North Carolina. It still gets down in the 40s and stuff like that. That's a hard way on a family right there. And it took a long time to get up. And I thought, have I got to do something with my house that I have something more than just one source to power my house with? I got to do something about that, you know, because I'm dependent on something. But Christ is not dependent on anything or anyone. That's what the self-existence I am means. It means he doesn't need anybody, okay? He doesn't need anything. He has always existed. There is no threat to him whatsoever. I always take time to slam dunk this doctrine when I can, is the doctrine of dualism, that somehow God and the devil are at war with one another. They're not at war with one another. God made the devil. The devil is God's play toy. God made him. He created him. He can snuff him out whenever he wants to snuff him out. He cannot do anything outside of what God allows him to do. There is no threat whatsoever to God with the serpent, with the devil. No threat at all. There's no threat. It was part of God's plan to make the devil. Is the devil good? In no way. Don't follow the devil. Shun the devil. Hate the devil. Okay? Don't even pray for the devil. You already know what the devil's fate is in the Bible. He has no hope whatsoever. Okay? He is gone. He's a tool of God being used for destruction and one day to be destroyed himself. But Christ himself is completely self-existent. All right, and this is what Jesus said, that therefore I said to you that you will die in your sins. For, and this is talking to like the Pharisees. He's talking to the highest religious leaders of the day in John chapter 8. The people most respected by the people is those who follow God. And he says, you're going to die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. It doesn't say unless you work a bunch of works or you do this. It's about the word believe. Do you believe in Jesus? And then, I'm going a little bit off passage, but not too bad. It's the same focus here. John 1:1-2. And he used this passage yesterday with JWs. I should have. It's such a good one for them to keep hearing. But they do hear it. They know about all the time. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. All right? He was in the beginning with God. And if you go down to John 1:14, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So who's the Word? It's Jesus. That's a beautiful verse showing the Trinity. Okay? That in the beginning, in all time, there was Jesus, there was the Father, and there was the Holy Spirit together. And the Word became flesh. And do you believe this, that Jesus is God? This is what I ask you today. Do you believe that Jesus is God? It is a mystery, okay? The Trinity is not something easy to understand or to grab your mind around. Truly, I think it might be best at times just to kind of believe it because the Bible says it and leave it there. Because our minds, I don't think, are capable of understanding three persons in one Godhead. You know, people will all try to say it's like water, it's like this, it's like that. Really, it's not. Those things all come out to some kind of cult, false religion type of worldview. We can't grab onto this. We've got to just trust what the Bible says and believe that in some kind of existence outside of our existence, it is that God exists in three persons in one God. And you have to, this is a fundamental belief. I think if you don't believe this, I don't believe you can be a Christian. I don't believe you can be saved. I don't believe that you can go to heaven if you don't believe this. Because like Jesus said, you would die in your sins if you don't believe that I am He. And yet it's a mystery, but being unable to understand it is not proof that He's not God. Just because we can't understand the Trinity isn't proof He's not God. There's a lot of things I don't understand at all. I don't understand a lot of math, okay? Now, basic math, I got that. But you can put me into some algebra, or even worse, calculus, or something like this. I have no clue what you're saying. It'll be like talking like a hog to a wristwatch when you're talking to me. That's what I'll be looking like. You'll be showing me something, you'll be like, look, what, can't you understand this? And I'll just be looking like a hog looking at a wristwatch, like I can't tell the difference between that and this. In this, I don't know. I don't get it, okay? And some of you may be math experts, but there's things that you probably don't understand either, okay? How something works. Maybe how your car works. If you understood everything, maybe you just fix your own car. If you know everything about cars, I'd like to be your friend, man, because I'm always trying to figure out some car stuff, too. But there's always something some of us don't understand, but yet we believe it, okay? I don't understand how they make some food taste good. I don't understand how ladies can cook so well, and some fellas can cook so well, but I like to eat it, and I trust it, and I eat it, and I enjoy it right there. And we should not, it's not a proof, it's not a valid excuse to say, I don't believe in the Trinity because I can't understand it. And that's where cults and stuff, they'll try to get you to do. Well, how do you understand that? I understand it because I believe what the Bible says, and the Bible says that Jesus is God. Right here, John 1:1-2. So they say, and this will be the sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. So this is a sign that they're telling the shepherds that they're going to have this sign to prove all this stuff that the angels have just said, that the great I Am has come into the flesh, the Savior and the Lord of the world has come. And the biggest thing was He's in a manger. You know, lots of women have babies all the time. Women are having babies everywhere in all of human history. But how many women are having babies and laying their babies in a manger, okay? In a place where animals are. You know, I don't know any mom that's doing that. You know, the moms either want to have their babies at home these days, some moms do, or they want to have their babies in a hospital. They want to have their babies in some clean, good place. They don't want to go to the manger, okay? They wouldn't go to the back animal stalls. They wouldn't go to my chicken coop, okay? Most ladies wouldn't even want to go in my chicken coop, okay? My wife says I need to clean it far more than I do. I would really do it when my neighbor tells me I need to clean it because they're within the smelling range of my chicken coop. So that really gets me if they tell me I need to clean it. But just imagine going to have a baby back there in my chicken coop. No lady would think about that. They would think you're crazy in the head. There's no way I'm doing something like that. But yet that's where Mary had her baby. And it probably smelled worse than my chicken coop did in that manger. And it says here, as Jesus himself put it when he had grown up, he did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He was born in the most humble of circumstances, in a manger. Christ didn't come, he came to show us how we should be as Christians. You know, as Christians, the leader as a Christian should be the most humble as a Christian. It says in the Bible that the first should be last, the last should be first. And the description that God gave, when Jesus gave to his disciples, when they all argued who's the greatest among us, and he's like, those of you who are the greatest servant, that's who's the greatest among you. That's how the kingdom of God works. That's how Jesus laid it out for us, and it gives us a whole different perspective than this false world perspective with all the pomp and all the grandness and all the power things. It's a totally different picture that we get right here. And another verse. It says, I, even I, am Yahweh, and there is no Savior besides me. So as people try to say Jesus is a Savior, but he's not God, Isaiah 43:11 says, there is no Savior except for one, except for God himself. And I wrote on top here, he is the Savior of all men in a temporal sense, and especially of believers in a spiritual sense. If you read 1 Timothy 4:10, that's what it says, that he's the Savior of all men, but especially of believers. So how do we understand that? We scratch our heads. Well, the way I understand it is he's the Savior of all men in the sense of a temporal sense, in the sense of a right here, right now. He's the one that helps us exist, move, live, have our being, have all these good things that we have in life. It all comes from Jesus Christ, no matter who you are. But he's especially the Savior of believers, because when you die and your eternal soul goes on forever, it's being saved by Christ to go to heaven if you're a believer in Jesus Christ. And he, it says in John 3:16 that he's the Savior of who? Of everyone who believes. And our true problem is that we need saving from sin. That's our biggest problem in our lives. Our biggest problem, if somebody says, what's your biggest problem? You know, we should say myself, okay? Myself is my biggest problem. And why is myself my biggest problem? Because I sin, and because I need saving from my sin. And truly, that's the truth. My first little chaplain training I did one time, CB in Akron City, some old wise chaplain that I like so much. Oh, I forget his name. He had kind of a strange name. His whole name sounded like one name. Mick, that was his name. Mick was his name. And he had another part of his name that sounded like Mick Kane. That was his name, Mick Kane. His last name was Kane, his first name was Mick. And he was a Bible-believing good fellow right there. He worked at St. Thomas in the psych ward there in the Akron City Hospital. And he was training, and everybody was talking about, what's your greatest fault, what's your greatest shortcoming in life? And he goes, myself. I am my greatest shortcoming. And I thought, everybody here said something, including myself, and that's the right answer right there. He got it right there and right then. And why would it be himself? Because he needs saving from his sin, because he knows that he sins and he needs God to save him from this sin. He needs a Savior, he needs a Lord. He did have the Savior and the Lord. He had Jesus Christ. It was beautiful. But God says that he is the only Savior. There's no other Savior side of him. You can't find salvation, you can't find wholeness, you can't find psychological help and band-aids and fix-its to your life anywhere outside of Jesus Christ and having your faith in him alone. Everything else is just temporary. Everything else, to go back like this, you know, the Savior, temporary, like Timothy 4:10 over here. That's where it all goes to, you know, a Savior in a temporary sense, but not in a Savior of a spiritual sense of forever and ever here. And my last one right here, outside of the scripture passages, okay, says Hosea 13:4, yet I have been Yahweh your God since the land of Egypt, and you are not to know any God except me. Notice that Jesus, little G, because there is no big G God except for one God. And he says, and there is no Savior besides me. So God's trying to explain this in Hosea to these folks. We're in Hosea right now. I don't know, maybe we hit 13th day even. Well, same passage I'm putting in here, being our daily Bible today. But look at this. All of the songs that we've done so far, as we're doing these songs through Christmas Advent, what do they call Jesus? Savior. Mary, she called Jesus her Savior. Zechariah called Jesus her Savior. The angels called Jesus the Savior, okay? It's the central theme, and it's unlike the gods of this world. The gods of this world all focus on a whole different focus than what we focus on here with Jesus Christ. And we're the only ones who have a God who actually rose from the dead. And when people doubt that, there is more literature written about that and about Jesus than about any other single person in all of human history. Okay? You can't say that this was just somebody's idea. You know, if you really try to be real with yourself and look at philosophy and look at ideas, you cannot get past the point of the resurrection. There says, and suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, and this multitude, possibly this was the biggest word they could use at the time. This would be the same as the word myriad, okay? And think about myriad was like 10,000. In the Revelations, it says there were myriads of angels, you know, which means 100 million angels plus that were singing and praising to the Lord. So we're not just talking about a few creatures, you know, a few angels that come to the shepherds. We're talking probably the sky lit up with these guys. We're talking that what they saw in front of them, as far as they could see to the left and right and everywhere, were these angels. And that's probably why such terrifying scents came over them. There was probably nowhere to run. There was nothing to do but fall on the ground in great fear. And this is what happens. It says, angel multitude all of a sudden appears with a heavenly host, and they're all praising God. The book of Revelation says angels are always praising God. It's something for sure. In heaven, we will be praising God, okay? If you don't want us to praise God today, and if you think that's a drudgery, then you got to repent today. Be like, God, help me. Get this sinful nature, that this draw in me that tries to draw me a wrong way. Get rid of it for me, Lord. Help me. Help me to come to a place that I just want to praise you, and that I can't think of anything better in life than to be at your feet praising you. And that's the right aspect, the right thoughts that we should have in this life. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. This is the last verse today, and it says, and I wrote, we will never have peace with one another until we have peace with God. You know, people on this world always say, we're going to have peace. I tell you, what were they talking? Weren't we talking into politics in America, Greenpeace and the Green Program or whatever it was called? And all of a sudden, Russia invaded Ukraine, and there's bombs going off all over the place, and there's people dying everywhere, and there's all, and that is talk of nuclear war. Imagine what that's going to do for the environment and stuff. We talk about peace, and here we are in the year 2022, about 2023, still on the verge of a giant World War III, or so much war everywhere. I tell you, somebody mentioned to me this morning, and I saw in the paper myself, is we're now training Somalias to be special forces once again. And they said their last president stopped, and our new president's gloating that he's doing this. And I'm like, oh great, we're training more enemies. There will be more war, and there will be more trouble. You know, I hope it works out. I really hope it's right, and they'll get all the bad terrorists in the country, and they'll make the world a safer place. But I don't know. I've seen a lot of things. You've seen a lot of things. We see how this world goes. And peace is not something that we're going to come about on a human level. Peace is found in Jesus Christ. And it's not found in something. It's not found in something that we can find or something we can do. It's only found in Christ alone. And I put that in Romans 5:1. And I didn't put the whole verse for you to see Romans 5:1. So maybe you want to look at Romans 5:1 at one point later today. But salvation is not for those of good will. Ephesians 2:9. You know how some people read this verse? You know, this is a Reformed verse. And I got to say, I love Reformed stuff, right? It says, on earth, peace among men with who? With whom he's pleased. It doesn't say with everybody. This doesn't say that Jesus came to bring peace to everybody. It doesn't say everybody's going to find peace. You know, the works-based salvation mode, you know how they understand this verse? They understand this verse that if you are a hard worker and your will goes in the right way, that's who God's pleased with right there, and that's who he'll bring peace with. But you know, if you truly read the Bible and you truly look at yourself and you realize yourself that you're a sinner, that there's no way that in and of yourself you can be good enough for God, that the only way that you can be saved is by what Christ did for you, and all your reliance is upon him, and it's not upon yourself, then that cannot work. That it's, you know, for who does good works, and that's who God is pleased with. It's whom he chose right here. It's whom God wills to be pleased with. And I tell you, that's something that's scary. It's scary because it shows us it's not something like a Unitarian thought. I tell you, even as Christians, none of us here are Unitarians. I know all you guys. And nobody I know here tells me they're Unitarian, that everybody's good and everybody's going to heaven. Nobody believes that, all right? And it's scary to know and to think and to really realize not everybody's going to heaven. Not everybody has Christ as their Savior. Not everybody's going to have this peace of God that's this such perfect peace. It's only for those who believe in God. Whoever believes, John 3:16, whoever believes is those who know that they have eternal life. Not may have, not might have, not have a chance at it, but it's got to be those who believe. And I truly do believe my own self. I mean, the Bible, the only way I can even believe is by the grace of God, but for the grace of God. That's why I believe, because of the grace of God. That's why you believe. If for some reason today, maybe somebody watching me on my little Facebook thing or video, and you don't believe, and you're thinking about believing, the only thing that makes you even think about believing is but for the grace of God. Because if the Holy Spirit doesn't draw somebody, there's no way they can be saved to begin with right there. And this is what it says, on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. All right? And Jesus was in a manger because there was no room for him anywhere else. And I got a question for you. Will you say to him, no room, there's no room in my heart today for you, God. There's only room for me and my ways. And I pray that that's not what you say. I pray that as you think about Jesus, as you hear my words, as you dig deep in the scriptures, that you're continually saying, God, have mercy on me. God, help me. God, draw me. God, let me be closer and closer to you. When we did this Revelation chapter 22 this last Thursday night, we got some good Bible studies, I'm telling you. If you guys can make it, you got to try to make it, man. We have good Bible studies here. We get into the depth of the Word, and we're honest with one another. And it says that those who are in heaven, and the last chapter of the Bible, are those who have washed their robes, you know. Now, how do we even get our robes of righteousness? They're all from Christ. But, you know, even as Christians, we still sin. We still mess up. We still have all kinds of stuff. And what do we got to do? We got to repent. We got to believe. We got to ask God for forgiveness. In the old picture like rubbing that robe up against a rock with a little water or something, trying to get that stain out of that robe right there, okay? They've washed their robes, and what do? They keep His Word. They keep His Word. And how many of us have so much trouble keeping His Word? If we're honest, we have to say all of us have trouble keeping His Word. And it's something that the way we do that is by continually going back in prayer to Him. Help me, God. Help me, Jesus. Help me to keep Your Word. Help me to follow after You. And truly, we got to ask ourselves honestly, do we have like the no more room available in my heart, God? I mean, I think, I saw a post on Facebook, one of you guys, and it's talked about church. And it said, people have hardly any time to go to church, they say, but yet, like the way that they watch TV or something, it shows they have a lot of time on their hands right there, you know? And yet church is such, I think it was something like 2 days in a year or something is the average church service. If 2 full days and that's it. If you go to church every Sunday, you're basically spending 2 full days of your 365 days in a year for God. And that's it. And yet for TV, we spend like weeks, months of our year. When you add that up, if you watch television and stuff, and you think that, to me, you think that, will you say to Him, no room? Like, no, you know, I just don't have time, God. And I tell you, how many people I run into that the slightest little thing will keep them from coming to church. And church doesn't save you, that's for sure. Church does not save you, doesn't make us go to heaven. But to me, how I picture church and my little word picture way that I think of things, I think of it like my cell phone. I had to plug it in today so the battery won't die on it. Hopefully it doesn't die in the middle of my little sermon here. But I got to recharge that thing, okay? I have to be recharged. How do I get recharged? From coming to church. From coming to church, from gathering with all of you, from fellowshipping with you, with talking with you, working some theology and doctrines out together, from praising the Lord together, from having other people pray for me and pray for other people. That's so special, and it's something that's so important. And I don't want to say in my life, I don't have any room for that. Because really, how many people do you see? There's a couple. We know a guy like John Barber, right? Nobody doubts John Barber wasn't a hardcore believer. And there were times in his life he had no church. He was going to all different churches. We actually were his church. Gave me the greatest compliment I ever had. Knowing him all his, well, a lot of his life, knowing him all my life, he's a lot older than I was. But he told me that we are his church. And man, did I feel good. Because I know how that guy went all around. And I thought, praise God, I got to be John Barber's church. But the thing is, most of us, when we get away from the church, we also get away from God. And everything else in our life starts to take dominance and God takes a back door, and it's really like we're saying, sorry, we don't have any room in our life for you, God. And we want to put God at the first foremost of our life for everything. And that doesn't mean that you can't go to church because something's going on. There's things that happen in life, but it should be a bit of a priority to us to gather. And really, it does kind of represent, you know, sometimes where is God in our life as well, too. You know, whether we even go to church or where do we believe. And my last slide to show you, you know, I kind of lied to you. I said no more of these other verse slides. I got one last one. Such a beautiful one about Christ. Colossians 1:20-22. And through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, although you were formerly alienated and enemies in mind and in evil deeds, but now he reconciled you in the body of his flesh through death, in order to present you before him holy and blameless and beyond reproach. So what do we get as Jesus is our Savior? Reconciliation. Reconciliation. And what a beautiful thing that is. If you've ever had somebody that you've had troubles with in life, and then all of a sudden you talk to them and things go good, reconciliation, and oh, what a peaceful thing that is. When the bad trouble and the bad feelings you had with somebody else, even as a Christian, you're struggling and trying to always forgive them and stuff, when that comes into your life and you truly get reconciliation, what a blessed thing reconciliation is. And the most important reconciliation of all things is with our Creator himself, with God. And that's who we get through faith in the Messiah, who's called the Prince of Peace, who's called God, and he reconciles sinners to himself. And this is what we have with Jesus Christ. And my last slide to show you, to ask you a question once again for yourself, do you have peace with God today? Is there peace in your heart with God? Something that hit me too with that Revelation 22 study too, in those last few verses, it says, Jesus says, I am coming soon. And you know what it says? Come, Lord Jesus. Okay, if you got red letter version, come, Lord Jesus is not in red letters. All right, so here you see, you know, it's all by God too, the Holy Spirit though. But here Jesus says, I'm coming. And he says, soon. And that was 2,000 years ago. So that's not most of our idea of soon. But that's the kind of attitude every one of us should have, is come, Lord Jesus, and come soon. And how many times I thought about it myself, do I think, well, maybe not just yet, Lord. I got some troubles going on today. You know, I'm not sure I'm ready to fix those troubles yet today. I'm not sure I'm ready to let go of that sin or whatever that is today. But think about that. Jesus says, I'm coming soon. The Bible says that the attitude should be, come, Lord Jesus, come soon. And it convicts me. It convicts me when I read that and when I see that, because I think not all the time do I feel like, oh, come today, oh, come right now, Lord. Because I find myself astray. I find myself in places I shouldn't be. And I need to repent. I need to draw closer to God. And I need to obey him. I need to come back to that place that's the right place to be. So I ask you today, do you have peace with God today? And I also ask you, is Jesus your Lord and your Savior? And remember what I said, Lord means in submission. You know, are you his slave? Is he your master? And is he your savior from your sin? Or do you deny the sin that you have? Eventually, after telling Mary what they had seen in verse 20, if we continued on for another 8 verses, the shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God. All these verses right here I listed are just in Luke. And what do? Is they always are glorifying and praising God. When they have an encounter with God, they glorify him and they praise him. And this characterizes all who know and love God. And I ask you one more question today. Do you praise God daily? Think about, when's the last time that you just started praising God? Just out of the blue, all by yourself, just praising him. Just being like, God, I praise you. I thank you. I give you glory. Thank you so much for forgiving me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for being there. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. How often do you praise God and just give him the glory? You know, it should be all the time. And I tell you what, be conscious about it. Do it. You know, push yourself. Effort. Strength. God gives you strength. He gives you strength to go toward him when you're saved. You know, he frees your will. Okay? We talk about free will all the time. When you get saved, he frees your will to go after him and to search him and seek him and truly to praise him. And I'll tell you what, If you want to talk about how you can live your best life now, like that crazy heretic Joe Osteen wrote a book about, the real way you can live your best life now is by truly a submission and service to God and praising Him and loving Him every day. And then every way that He made you to be on this earth, you're following right in that pattern. And if you think about it, think about a body, okay? I work in a hospital, I see bodies all the time. If you're a body that smokes all the time, you're likely to maybe get COPD one day. You know, you won't hardly breathe right anymore. And you'll have to have machines and stuff hooked up for you. And it'll be trouble. You know, my buddy Dave, you know, Dave can't make it here today. He's looking at a nursing home, he told me. And I bet you if you ask Dave why he got the COPD, he'll probably say, because I smoked my whole life right there, you know? And there's things that can we do to ourselves that can hurt us. And if you think, if the people all in the health food and eating healthy and doing the right thing and exercising, drinking water, that's always a good thing no matter what, right? Now we're talking about we got clean water, different things. Whoever knew we'd have bottled water a long time ago. But here, we do all these things, but the most important way to live this life of all is to live it for Jesus Christ, your Creator, exactly how He made you to live it. And that is the way you can live the best life you could possibly live now. And I tell you, you're still going to have troubles, you're still going to have tribulations and sufferings and trials, but you can have inexpressible joy as you go through those trials and through those troubles, because you know you have Christ. So this is what I ask you today. And with this, I'm going to do communion. Jason, you can help me do communion here. Have as many folks. And as we get ready to do communion, truly every time we do communion, it's a reflection of what we actually believe. You know, when you take communion, it's like you are testifying and saying, yes, I believe in you, Lord Jesus. My faith is in you. I know that I'm a sinner. I know that you had to die for me, that you had to give your blood up for me, and I praise you for doing that. And I ascribe to you my faith by taking this communion. And it is the right attitude for us to have. We should never do it flippantly. We shouldn't do it because the grape juice tastes good, okay? We shouldn't do it because everybody else does it. We should do it because it's something that's God-honoring down in our soul right here. So take a moment as you take the communion cup and pray to get right with God and to just ask Him to forgive you and draw close to Him here this day. Don't let it be wasted for another day, but make it today. Even the little guy's praying. I can hear him. We take this cup and we take our little wafer off at the top. You guys are all pros at this now. That's the only gameplay has trouble with anymore. We're really good at this. But we take this and we break and we remember that Jesus' body was given for us. This Messiah, this baby. You know, we love babies. There's a beautiful baby back there. I tell you, if somebody came in to hurt the baby, I bet we'd all be protecting that baby. We'd be like, run to the back. We'll take care of these evildoers and these bad ones right here. But we love babies so much, but that same, and I tell you, I think about my little girl all the time. She was my first baby, and I think about the day she was born, and I still, every time I look at her, I think of her as my baby, okay? Even at work, all the time, I talk about my little guy. That's what I call my boy all the time, and the priests at work are like, he's not so little, he's 15, he's 5'9". Why do you keep calling him little? And I said, he'll not be my little guy. But we think about this. And Jesus was God's only begotten Son. And He loved Him so much that He gave Him up for you and I. And think about how tremendous that love is right there. It's as deep could be. And it is what Christmas is all about. We've got the greatest gift in the entire world. You know, I like that we get gifts at Christmas. But we should think, what's the greatest gift we could ever got at Christmas? Is Jesus Christ. And that's what we got. So we take this bread, remembering what Christ did for us. And then we have this cup here, and we get ready to take you.